Góðan daginn og verið velkominn á þennan fund sem ber yfirskriftina er hægt að ná samstöðu næstu skref í stjórnarskrármálinu. First few words in Icelandic. Fundurinn fer fram á ensku af því að frummælandin okkar enskumælandi en að sjálfsögðu fólk vill tjá sig á íslensku þá get ég bara snarað því yfir ef það einhverjar spurningar eða komment sem fólk finnst þægilega að bera fram á okkar tungumáli þá að það hefði minnsta mál. Áður en við byrjum þá vil ég Before we start, I would like to tell you that the meeting should be over at 10 minutes past one, because some of the panelists have a meeting that starts shortly after that. So we'll try to keep it short and concise, and we still haven't decided exactly what's going to happen. We will see when we hear Larry's speech and when we sort of figure out what the questions that we want to raise are. So I just want to say that I'm very happy to see that so many people have arrived. This is a important issue to our society and it's wonderful to see that so many people take interest and especially that the political parties are trying to figure a way to advance this matter. So next I would like to introduce Lawrence Lessig, who is a wonderful person and a great thinker. He's also a lawyer and a professor at Harvard and economist and loads of fancy stuff, but he is here to say a few words in regards to this process. And I will not use more time, but just welcome you, Larry, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And it's so wonderful to see so many here. Here's the question. What are you going to do for democracy in the world? Right, that sounds like an odd question to ask in Iceland. It's a small place. You might not think of yourselves as central to the future of democracy in the world. But what I want to do in the next 3 minutes is try to convince you just why Iceland is so central to the future of democracy in the world. Because if you think about democracy across the world, it's failing across the world. And it's failing because ordinary people feel like their leaders don't listen to them. And like a five-year-old child, at a certain point, they have to act out. And they have to act out in a way that gets the attention of their leaders. So think about what's happened in Britain with Brexit, or in Germany with the AfD party, or in the United States with Donald Trump. Today, there was an extraordinary article published in the New York Times about a poll of Americans trying to understand how is it possible that Americans are actually contemplating electing Donald Trump as their president. And what the poll showed is that a significant majority of Americans believe Hillary Clinton's values are closer to their values than Donald Trump. A significant portion of Americans think that Hillary Clinton has the right temperament to be president more than Donald Trump. A significant majority believe that her policies on immigration, on defense, on national security are better than Donald Trump's. But the most important reason we are even talking about Donald Trump is that the vast majority of Americans think Donald Trump actually is an agent of change for democracy in America, and they think Hillary Clinton is the status quo. And so Americans are toying with the idea of electing a man who fantasizes about using nuclear weapons as their president because they are so deeply frustrated with the failure of democracy in America. Now, there are many people who, when they look at the way democracy has failed, think maybe we should try something else. I was at a conference in Aspen and invited to dinner the house of a very wealthy American, and the dinner was filled with a bunch of wealthy Americans, and they were fantasizing about how we could end democracy. We could adopt something like a Chinese model with experts or technocrats at the very top and just give up the idea of democracy because they too were convinced democracy had not worked. But I am a Democrat. And I believe it's critical to show people around the world that democracy is possible, that people can actually do something. And that's why I came here, not just here today, but that's why I came here to Iceland with my family this fall. Because 8 years ago, when you, like the rest of the world, confronted the collapse of your economy, you discovered that that collapse was tied to a problem in your government. And what you did in response to that was something no one else in the world did. You motivated each other to begin a process of constitutional reform, a crowdsourced constitution, which began with an incredible process of gathering the attitudes, the ideas of ordinary Icelanders, representative sample of 1,000 people to say what the values of a constitution should be. And then you began a process to draft a constitution. In 4 months, you drafted a constitution. It took our founders 4 months too, but our founders didn't post the drafts to Facebook every week. And after that process, you had an election, a referendum, where more than two-thirds of Icelanders endorsed the idea of the constitution. And when I tell this story around the world, at each of these chapters, people are amazed. And then I tell the story that the parliament did not adopt the constitution. And they are amazed again, because they can't understand how such an extraordinary expression of democratic will is ignored. Now, I know the story is complicated. I know there are people who have legitimate questions about this constitution. I know that every constitution is imperfect, and this one too. But the question I hope we can have a conversation about is whether it's possible to recognize this constitution as an extraordinary expression of democratic will, and to adopt it as a first step, and to recognize as the first step it needs to be changed. Our constitution was adopted and immediately amended. The first 10 amendments were adopted within 2 years after our constitution. But if that happened here, if the next chapter of this story were that the opposition parties here agreed to make this change fundamental, then that too would be an extraordinary, surprising next step in the story about how democracy in Iceland had worked. Now, I think you need a constitution, but I don't really argue for this because of what you need. I think we, citizens of the world, need an example of democracy working. And the reason we need you to do this is I'm sure it will make your democracy work better, but it will make the possibility of democracy around the world seem hopeful again. And we can take this story all around the world and say we can learn and follow the lead that happens here. You started something extraordinary 6 years ago, and that chapter, the next chapter, can make that even more extraordinary now. So I'm grateful we're having this conversation, and I'm eager to hear what we can do to make this hopefulness for democracy something the whole world can celebrate. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Larry, for that inspirational talk. I just want to shortly introduce who's here in the panel. It's Birgitta Jónsdóttir from the Pirate Party. It's Valgerður from the Samfylking. It's Theodóra Þorsteinsdóttir from Björt Framtíð, Katrín Jakobsdóttir from Vinstri Grænn, Jón Ólafsson, philosopher at the University of Iceland, and Ragnhildur Helgadóttir, professor of law in the University of Reykjavík, and of course, Lawrence. My name, I forgot to tell you, my name is Katrín Oddsdóttir. I am a lawyer and also the chairman of the board of the Constitution Society, Stjórnarskrárfélagið, which is a small NGO trying to advance this matter. So, I think what we would do now is just hear maybe very short comments from Larry's speech, from each and everyone in the panel, if you like. And I would be very thankful if you could keep it short so we can then have a dialogue with the people who are here in the room. So if I'll just start with you, Ragnhildur, at that end, because that's unusual. Can you just, if you have any comments or sort of, if you have any sort of thoughts on where we are at this process, that would be very good, please.
One thought, I think, looking back, that one mistake that has been made is to conflate the process and the output. So those who are rightly very much in favor of the process, they talk about the process that took place and its importance. Those who criticize the output are simply talking about a very different thing. So it seems to me like the discussion on this topic in Iceland has very much been at cross purposes, and that people hear different things because they are simply talking about different issues. So I think that while many lawyers have lots of criticism for the output, not a lot of people would actually argue with the description that we just heard about the process.
Jón?
Yeah, it's difficult to be very brief and to sort of address the whole issue nevertheless, but I just want to say this, that I think that in the process of making the constitutional draft, which I think is extraordinary, just as Larry explained, and I think we all agree about that, there's also this complicated question of, to use a boring term, the political reality. And the thing is that once the draft had been made and submitted, there was total confusion among the politicians what they should actually do with it. So we had 3 years of this, well, or 2 years maybe, 2.5 years of this confusion before the process ended. And in the spring of 2013, it looked that as if the political reality was simply that the project was dead. This has radically changed now in this year. And I think that unrelated events, Panama documents and things like that, have simply brought the project back, brought it alive again. So I think that we suddenly have a possibility to think through dealing with the product, what we can do with the constitution we actually have. The draft that was that the parliament was discussing 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. So the question for me now is, and this I think is the really important thing, what is it that the politicians can do actually to deal with it, to take this up, and not to be totally confused again? And my fear is that we're going to have elections in just over a month. And if the parties, or if a number of parties, it could be the opposition parties here, it could be some other parties too. I don't care personally about what parties would do that. But I'm afraid that if there is not a block of parties that actually has a plan before the elections about what to do after the elections, we will have the same confusion after the 29th October all over again. So I think this is a crucial moment now before the elections to have a few parties, preferably enough parties that will then actually be in a majority, whatever they will do about coalition government and so on, to have a common declared policy on what they're going to do with the constitutional draft. I think that's the main thing now.
Thank you. Katrin?
Thank you, Larry, and sorry for being late. That the process that we started with Þjóðfundur, our national meeting in 2010, and what has happened afterwards is a very valuable and a unique process and something that we need to somehow bring into harbor, if we can say that. And we have spent a lot of time in the politics to argue about whose fault what it is, what happened. But I think now maybe is the time, and I agree with Jón, that we look ahead and try to form a plan, and that is something that we have been discussing between the opposition parties, but hopefully some more parties, that we need to think ahead how we are going to sail this ship to the harbor. So we will respect the process, respect the referendum in 2012, and also works sensibly, because it's important what Larry also said, that constitutions aren't the final product. They can be amended, as you described in your speech here. And, but we need to be loyal to this democratic process, which is in many ways unique, and as I said, was started in 2010. So I think it would be really important that as many parties as possible would form a plan, and that was really the result of those representatives of the parties who actually now sat in the constitutional committee that's been working in this, this period, that it was really important to finish that process that started with the Thjóðfundur 2010. And we need to think of a plan how we can engage the general public again, how we can re-invoke the discussions about the constitution, and how we will finish the process so that we can all be proud of that.
Thank you. Theodora?
Yes. Can you hear me? Yes, okay. Yes, my political party, Björt Framtíð, wants the new constitution of the basis of the recommendation of the Constitutional Council, as we know. And I thank you for a very good presentation here. It was, I'm new here because I'm the chairman of the City Council, and I've not talked a lot about this constitutional cases here, but I strongly think that we should keep on develop. I'm not sure how long time it will take, 4 years, 8 years. I think it has to be developed and keep on working for that. So I think at least we have to be proud what, as Larry said, what we have been doing for the last 6 years.
Thank you. Valgerður.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your introduction. I like to refer to the to what happened in the last sort of last term of parliament as a democratic experience. And I think that it was sort of as our guest said, it was unique. We were not able to carry it through to the end, that's true, but we obviously see today that the process is still going on. I do not think that is because of the politicians. I don't think it's our work to have kept it going. I don't think that the committee that we've been sitting on for 3 years and discussing first four and then three articles into the new articles into the old constitution. I don't think that work is what has kept it alive. I think it's the will of the, shall I say, the will of the people, the will of it's apparent in this sort of meeting here, all these people meeting. People are interested in this. People would like the politicians to finalize the work that was started in the last, sort of in 2010. And why was it started? The political parties had not been able, we have not been able to finalize this work since 1944. It was said in 1944, this is preliminary, we need to sort of redo it, and that has never been accomplished. So in 2010, the parliament decided on a new way to do it, and there was the, in the beginning of the process, that is something I want to sort of point out also. In the beginning of the process, there was an agreement in parliament, in the parliamentary committee who dealt dealt with this to come to a compromise. So it was just when it, when it showed that this was being accomplished, then there's a lot of people who have the power in this country, be their political party wrongly represented in the parliament because of disequal, unequal voting rights, be they the sort of academics, be they the media, everyone sort of spoke this down. And I must say that I have been sort of, I have admired the people who sat in the council, ordinary people, not politicians, that they sort of, I don't know what they should have done, but how their work was sort of spoken down, it was just amazing for me to listen to that. And I think it's the political duty of politicians to bring this work to end, but I don't think that the politicians will be able to do it. I think that we have to come to some agreement that we will again refer this to somebody else, be it the old council or not. I don't have exactly who should do it, but what we should agree to is that we will, the majority, that we will sort of adopt whatever comes out of it. Because we are not able to finalize this work. That's like it is. And it's no thanks to us that it's still alive today. It's for other people to thank for that.
Thank you, Lawrence, for an incredibly inspirational speech. I think if we look at this entire process, what has kept the debate and the passion for the new constitution has been the inspiration to get a new social agreement for the new Iceland. I was in many think tanks that were sort of naturally popped up after the collapse, and there was all this discussion that we needed to build on a solid foundation, New Iceland, because people felt so disturbed by everything that was revealed. A lot of people knew about it, it was just straight in our face. And so perhaps if we approach it, this idea that we make a decision before elections that we are going to put the new constitution as one of our top priorities, or a top priority, Pirate Party has already made a policy about that. It would be awesome if all the other parties would do the same, and we're certainly willing to work with people that are willing to go on this or carry on this important journey. It is a journey, like Larry said, that has inspired many people all over the world, and me and Katrin, we've been to many different events where, you know, democracy, direct democracy, and the constitutional process in Iceland has been the inspiration for the debates. But we need to bring that enthusiasm back home. And I think we are never going to be able to change the constitution only within the parliament or only within the academia. We need to bring all these different groups together, and we need to have a plan on how we can get people from all over Iceland to feel enthusiastic and inspired and believe that we need to do this together. So yes, it is an extreme responsibility of people that are representatives to put this on the agenda. I have certainly done that because this is the thing that gets me up in the morning. This is the thing that I really believe can move us forward. I feel so much hurt in Iceland. I feel so much distrust. And I feel that people are so sick of politicians from all different parties of being promising stuff they can't possibly do. And that is why I feel it's also very important that those parties that want to work together, they can see that it is possible to work together, say so before elections. I think it is very important. And I also think that we need to try to bring as many other parties into this mix of the new parties. I mean, the Conservative Party has already said they don't want any big system changes. And it is going to change the foundations of our society if we get this new constitution in a really positive way. But it's power is a funny thing. It's very difficult to let go of it for many people. But yeah, I think we can do it. I know we can do it. And I'm ready. We are ready.
Great. I think what we would like to do now, thank you all so much for your input, would be to maybe see if there's any comments or questions from the room. There is. And take at least 10 minutes into that. And maybe I would like then to go back to the panel. So we'll sort of tie it up and we're going to leave this room at 1:10, just so that's certain, because people have to be elsewhere then. So please, if there are questions, yes, I'll try to. So starting here with Guðmundur, who else?
My name is Guðmundur Ragnar. I'm very pleased that you asked for comments, because I have a comment, also maybe a question. This is very parliament-centric discussion regarding the process. It really started before this 1,000 people coming together, slightly superficial discussion of what people think is important. This Stjórnarskrafélag, what's it in English?
Constitutional Society.
Yeah, Constitutional Society had started, and other grassroots had started, and there were deep discussions, like really deep discussions about what we should do. And the group of people that were participating was growing. So I saw the politicians grab the initiative and shrinking it down to a measurable project that could be controlled. And if the other process would have been allowed to grow, we would have a stronger support for a similar constitution as the one we are discussing now. So the grassroots initiative was cut short by introducing this process. I'm not complaining about this process, but people say it started with this process. That is not true. The real process was going on and it was cut short. And people's participation in the process was reduced, and the political pressure from people was reduced because they did not see it as there, because they had not had a deep discussion. I'm very emotional about this, I'm sorry, but I think what Birgitta was saying and many others was that if we get people involved in the discussion of why do we need the change, then we're going to get the political pressure from people, the population, general population. So I'm really upset about it. It did absolutely not start the way that people here perceive that it did.
Yes, thank you. There's two questions or comments over there to my right side.
Yes, hello, my name is Snæbjörn. I would like to ask a representative of Björt Framtíð if it's truly their position that we should take 8 years to finish the process, or 4 or 8 years, I just heard that, and I just would like to get a clarification on that.
Yes, I said I don't know how long time it takes, if it takes 4 years or 8 years, and we have to keep on working it. And I think we need to develop it, but I believe that we can finish it and put it to the end next years.
So you see the ratification of a new constitution as something that should happen in after 1 or 2 or 3 terms, perhaps?
Hopefully very soon.
Okay.
With the help of the nation.
Hi, my name is Huye. I'd like to ask Larry a question. And so when I've talked to academics, especially legal academics, about the viability of the new constitution. A lot of them like appeal to some sort of mystical authority about, well, there is so much legal precedent, it's going to create instability. And it's kind of like appeal to authority that I have a hard time answering, although I feel that like that's not a good, I feel that it's not a good reason not to do it. So could you comment on that?
Yeah, and I'd like to comment in a way that connects to the first comment. I think the most important sense of authority that democracy needs is the belief that the government is connecting to the attitudes of the people, the genuine attitudes of the people. So you're absolutely right. What was so extraordinary before Parliament intervened in this process was the way there was a really genuine, I saw it on the web, the genuine effort to pull together a grassroots crowdsourced process, which was in some sense captured and steered in a certain direction, but it really was the process that could give people a belief that there was a reason to have faith that a democracy would respect the people. And that's why I was saying, if in fact this election forced the parties, the parliament, to finally respect even the short-circuited process there, that would create the meaning of how democracy would work, much more important than I think these abstract ideas about stability and legal practice. Let the stability be a stable idea that democracy follows the will of the people and respects it. Let that be the stable principle. And then you would have set an example for a democracy that exists literally nowhere in the world today. And that's, I think, the real opportunity here. So again, I hear the legal quibbles with the Constitution, and I teach constitutional law, and I understand the things they're talking about. But that's not a reason not to adopt the Constitution. That's a reason to perfect the Constitution once you've adopted it. Because the adopting of the Constitution means the people matter. The people are sovereign. The people have spoken, and we are going to respect that. And then the lawyers can worry about whether Article 27 should be modified in one way or the other.
Thank you. Victor?
Hi, my name is Victor. I am running with the Pirates, and thank you for a very good meeting and an inspirational talk. I would like to ask, we are discussing within the Pirate Party now a proposal for a sort of clear plan for adopting a new constitution, which involves keeping up the process that ended in 2013, working with that document that was created by the Constitutional Council, only making minor changes if necessary on that and in the spirit of the initial proposals, and then putting these proposals, working them towards the final bill for a new constitution that the people would get to vote on again in a referendum, yes or no, on a final proposal from Parliament. And I would just like to ask the political representatives here if they would be willing to commit to this, to if they get into position if you together get into the position to commit to bringing the people a full new constitution based on this work that they get to vote on before the next end of the next term or at the end of the next term. Thank you.
Great. So I think this means we will go and shortly just get a sort of yes, maybe no from the political representatives. And of course, this is just based on their own sort of feeling at the moment. They have not formed probably their political strategies within their membership. So just respect the fact that they're talking on their own behalf. Yes, please.
It's a little bit weird to answer somebody from my party, but I've looked at this process and I think that it's extremely important that we create a frame that the parties that want to do this together, if it's all of these parties and more parties, then it would be very useful to have a solid framework. So, yeah. But it's important to remember that our national referendum according to the current constitution is not binding, and that is why the parliament could bypass the referendum, which was, I think, the most disgraceful act ever in our democracy.
Thank you. Okay, Valgerður.
Well, obviously we have to have a frame. Obviously we have to have a plan. I mean, it depends on what the plan is, if you say yes to it or no to it. The problem is, of course, that we have to change the constitution as the constitution says. We cannot start a new constitution with ignoring our constitution. It's impossible. And it was a different time then. It was a different time. We were establishing it a little bit shows the difficulties in our discussions that people come and say, this is what we did in 1944. We are now in 2016, and there are different times. And the Constitution says that the last thing that you have to do in Parliament is to agree to a change in the Constitution, then you dissolve Parliament, you have new elections and new Parliament. And that has, and we have to, at least that's my belief, that if a new Constitution should be such that we all believe in it, that we trust in it, or something like that, that it is at least legally binding. It has been born by the legal tools that we have, even though we disagree with the tools. Therefore, I know politicians, I think what would be the best thing to do now, because we have this sort of bráðabirðaákvæði, we have that now.
Preliminary
article, which says that Parliament can agree on changing the constitution with 2/3, then it goes to a referendum, and if the referendum says yes, then it's a new constitution. And I think that if we could agree in this Parliament, if we could get people to get the sort of majority parties to have a new article of this kind, then I think that would be the way to change the constitution. Because, I mean, if politicians are politicians, and politicians are human beings also. So when you come and say, okay, let's have a 9 months parliament, and we'll do this with the constitution, and then we'll all go to a new elections. Then people say, oh, but the old people, we have to help them. And we all know how the health system is, and we all know how this is. So it's just because I know us. I know how we are. So I think that is not the best solution. I would be willing to sort of agree to it. But I think the other thing would be the way to get this forward, to save this gym that we have, gym.
Very good. We're going to have Theodore and Katrin, and then a comment or question from the room.
Yes, the question from the gentleman at the back, we are still...
Yes.
Yes.
Just briefly, please.
Yes, just brief. My answer is yes. I think we should create a frame and work together.
Good.
Next step.
Thank you, Victor, for your question. My party has agreed several times that we want to follow the conclusion of the referendum where the majority said that we want to build on the draft of the new constitution. So absolutely, what we have been talking about in my party, where there is a constitutional group, that next step is to really build such a frame, how we can finish this process, as I said before, be loyal to the process that we started, and find a reasonable way. What Valkyrður said here about the how to change the constitution, it's my personal belief. I know that that what was agreed upon in parliament was not only 2/3 of the parliament, but also 40% of the public. And that's a very high threshold. And that amendment, if you can call it that, was really where, what could be done in Parliament at that time. However, I think it would be better if we would manage in Parliament, for example, now, and I said that during the discussion about the constitutional changes that have now been suggested by the Prime Minister, that the best thing we could do was to find a decent way to change the constitution so the process can be finished by Parliament and the general public. But I'm not very optimistic that that will happen. So that's why I think we need to build a frame how we can do this within the framework that we have in the current constitution, sadly.
Yes. Thank you. Thorvaldur.
I am Thorvaldur Gylfason. I want to thank Professor Lessig for his helpful presence in Iceland, and I want to make a quick comment and a quick question. The comment is, when the political establishment fails to abide by the rules, experience shows that one sometimes needs to adopt a new constitution by what is known as extra-constitutional means. This was done in France in 1958, and let's not forget, this was done in Iceland in 1944. The 1944 constitution was adopted by exactly the means that are stipulated in the new constitution, a simple majority in parliament and a simple majority in a national referendum. End of story. My quick question is to the four representatives of all the parliamentary opposition parties. It's 6 months till the election. Why haven't you already promised the voters to cooperate if you win a majority in the election and finish the ratification of the constitution? Are you really going to let more weeks pass before you address this issue in your conversations with the voters?
Thank you. Very quick responses, because next I would like to go and get some feedback from our experts on the right wing there, from my position, just to see if they have any comment on what sort of framework we could be talking about, so we can try to advance this methodology that we're trying to form, or we seem to agree upon that we need to form. So just to answer first Thorvaldur question, I would like to start now with Katrin.
Well, the reason that we are having this meeting together, the opposition parties, is that we want to have a very clear vision before the next election. And I think this meeting is a very important step, and we are very grateful to Larry for being with us, and Ragnhildur and Jón, because we need to build a broader consensus on how we are going to proceed. And we have spent enough time really not getting any results. So I think this is a very important meeting, a first step in how we can move ahead.
Thank you. Theodora.
Yes, I'm so inspired by being here, by listening to you and all the questions and all the people in this room. So I totally ask the same question. So we have to start from now, at least from my behalf, and I agree with Kata, it's important to be here, and we have to start from now, I think. It's my opinion. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Valgerður.
This is a step towards that. I mean, we have obviously not done it, so this is the first step. Be thankful for that.
Excellent. Birgitta?
Yes. We've been talking about this for a long time, and I think, when you throw things out into the ether and just test, if people are interested in it, and then I'm talking about the people, then it's important to proceed with it. And I feel that the current of interest in the new constitution is getting heavier and heavier and heavier, and I really feel it is possible. I really believe that we can do this. Just like Theodora said, she came here and she's talking about these things for the first time, and she's feeling inspired. This is a really great meeting, and I want to thank also Stjórnarskrárfélagið and Katrín for actually trying to facilitate a platform we've met before, where people from the opposition have been talking together to try to find a way forward. And so now we don't have a lot of time, but we are really you know, those of us here are, you know, really busy in the parliament because it's the crazy times. And there's another thing that we really have to focus on, which is equally important, to make parliament work, the heart of democracy, the heart of representation. Mm. So I am just astonished that nothing's really changed there in the time I've been there. But I think all of us who are in here, and all of us that feel inspired and feel that this is an important thing, you know, let's just spend some hours every day to try to get people into Theodora's place, where, you know, you feel by getting information about this and how important it is that you need to, you have a responsibility to bring it forward. Mm-hmm. So do not expect the politicians to deal with this alone. This is not going to happen. This is our job collectively.
Thank you. Thank you. I was just also going to frame a thought I just had, which is the fact that now we have in Iceland a new political party called Viðreisn, which seems to be accumulating a lot of interesting and in many ways intelligent and clever people. And in my opinion, that's my opinion, and in my opinion I think they should be of course approached as well, because they are not already formed their policy, and hopefully they would like to participate. I think we have a very strong message from both Framsóknarflokkur and Sjálfstæðisflokkur that they don't want to participate in this, and I think they should be asked again, just so everybody is invited to the table, and all other parties, of course. And sort of would like people, know people from these parties or sort of can get this going, to ask and to try to figure out if we can do this together. I mean, we are a nation, and these are part of the, it's not us and them, I think. And I think we have spent enough time being frustrated with the politicians and blaming them, and now probably we have to start trying to advance it. So I'm very thankful and happy that you are here today and you are discussing it. And though I do slightly share your frustration, I still think we are on a note now which is much more constructive and hopeful. Now I'd like to ask the experts on the end there, starting with Jón, who I know has given this quite a lot of thought, if they have any sort of a roadmap or suggestions that could help in regards to how we could form this process if there's an alliance after the election, and that alliance has the majority. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that it's very important not only to have a broad agreement, but also to have a plan for something. And I totally agree with what Birgitta and some other people have said here, that this is not something that the parliament can simply do. It's not a situation where the parliamentarians after the elections can just complete the task. They have to do it in a partnership with the public. So the question is really, how can you actually rekindle the spirit of the general participatory effort that was made here in 2011? I think this is not an easy task. There's a lot of cynicism, there's a lot of negative attitudes in the society at large towards the constitutional process. We don't have really the poll data that we need to see how the public is actually viewing the constitution right now. Have the attitudes changed from what they were in the referendum of 2012? Or are they basically the same? Is the support more? Is it less? So I think that the main thing is that to some extent the process has to be opened up again. And this means that taking the text, the current draft, people who are dealing with it have to be open to it being changed. But the ways that such changes can happen must be very carefully thought out. It should not be opened up completely. But I could, for instance, imagine a process where we would have a series of deliberative meetings in the spirit of the national forums of 2009 and 2010 that would actually give directions about what considerations should sort of guide the finalization of the constitution. And I think this is a plan like that is pretty easy to do. There's a lot of methods that have been tried in other countries with much success, and we don't have to invent the wheel in that respect. There is, for instance, the method of deliberative polling, which has been around for over 20 years. that can actually give you tangible results about what people think, having given real thought to the problems that they are dealing with, and so on. So I think really to have a plan, it could be a one-year plan, it could be a two-year plan, it could be a four-year plan. Depends on the strength and the will of the politicians again, but within that plan there should be public consultation to a considerable extent, and also some idea about how to guard the process against being subverted and destroyed by its enemies. There are always going to be enemies to this process. I mean, it's obvious. So I think what I think would be an interesting way to go is for the politicians who are actually preparing for elections to sit down and see whether they can work out a relatively simple plan that can then be presented before the elections, so that everybody's going to know before the elections what is going to happen about the Constitution, given that there is a majority for that plan. So, I mean, I'm not saying much about what the actual plan might be. I think the main thing is that it is simple, that it involves public consultation, and that there is no fear that this is going to be taken away again.
Thank you so much. Ragnhildur?
Thank you. I would like to make recommendations, not in particular to any or all of these political parties, but to those who want to move on with this project beyond the steps that are already being taken. There are changes that lie before Parliament now. Incremental, yes, but there are amendments being proposed. I think, and this is where I must raise a critical voice, I think that we need to keep critical thought concerning a new constitution absolutely alive. And that means toning down the rhetoric. And that's not only because it's a sign of respect for everyone, not to call people traitors for letting something fall asleep in Parliament. It's a sign of respect in public debate, which is good. But also because we must remember that in the parliamentary elections of 2013, which took place after the referendum, two parties came in with a clear agenda regarding the draft, and they got a majority of the votes. That is, a functional majority, but that is also the will of the people. So if you go around saying, and this is something that has happened, if you go around saying people are enemies of the process, you are alienating a big portion of the voters who voted for these parties for one reason or another. So I think toning down the rhetoric and moving on would be a good thing. With regard to the elections in 2013, as I say, but also in order not to fall into the same pits as this project has fallen before, we all need to open our minds and to address, not criticize, not argue with, but address in some way or another the criticism that has come out. For instance, in the Venice Commission's, the Venice Committee's report. One of the reporters there, for instance, was the Danish ombudsman. I refuse to believe that the Danish ombudsman has a specific vested interest in holding down Icelandic democracy. It simply means that we are talking about a different issue. This is why I pointed to the difference between the process and some of the outcome before. So I think that keeping all this in mind, so as not to make the same mistakes is too strong, but so as not to end up in the same situation again, might be a good idea.
So I want to agree with both of these statements, but pull them together. Jan is emphasizing the need for simple but deliberative. And I agree, now my dean, I have to say, because I've been so well cared for by your law school. My dean emphasizes the need to do it in a respectful, deliberative way. But I'd suggest this one tweak here. If we're going to keep it simple, I think the way to keep it simple is to commit that the first step is to adopt as a foundation what's happened, and to agree, following that, to launch into the process that Jan is describing, of a deliberative series of conversations about how that foundation should be changed. Because the point about the first step, the simple first step, is that the public would understand that that means the public has been respected. The ambiguities of elections are many, but at least this is a way to say the referendum has been respected. And now we're going to continue the respect in the way Jan has described. I'm a big supporter of deliberative polls, by engaging the public in an ongoing process to build this public that was short-circuited as a contributor to that conversation. But you need the way for the public to believe you've actually respected them. And I fear that if we start a process that's another 8 years of let's get the draft perfect and then adopt it, the message from that will be, you haven't respected us yet. And then what happens is revolution. I mean, I completely agree with you about the history of constitutions. Let's add the American Constitution to that as well. The American Constitution was completely illegally adopted. Completely illegally adopted. But it was because the people at a certain point had had enough of the old government and they said, fine, we're going to start again. I'm a conservative. I don't want to see that happen. I would love to see Parliament demonstrate that they can be representative and that they can respect the will of the people. And so this is a simple way, it seems, to get both of these, to take the first step, to say we've adopted it, and then take the second step. Now we have to figure out how to make it perfect. And I think those two things together would be an enormous contribution to the possibility of parliamentary democracy.
Thank you. Now, we have about 9 minutes left. I would like to throw out one idea, which is, I don't know if it's bad or good, but I'm thinking how can those parties that seem to be all very willing today to do this, to make this commitment and make this happen, how can they somehow symbolically make this alliance, you know, when they don't have the whole process mapped out, which is only normal, and we know that in the next few weeks they will have enough on their plates and they'll probably not be spending 8 hours a day mapping out the process. Let's be realistic about that. But I was wondering, could you, for example, put the bill forward as the first legal bill of if you got the majority? As that would be a sort of a principal stance saying this is a priority. Could it be the first case that you ever, for example, put in the new parliament if you were in majority? Could you find a way such as to show and promise that this will go on? Or, yes, okay.
Yes.
So Birgitta, yeah,
well, it's a very good and nice idea. I like it.
I think it's a really interesting idea that you put forward here, Lawrence. I would like to think about that idea, whether it's possible to agree first and then make the amendments. And I also think that it's really important that all these parties here say very clearly, at least before the election, whether they have mapped out the whole process in before, at least that they have mapped out the big idea, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be detailed, but it has to be mapped out, the big idea, how this is going to happen. And I think we owe that to the voters, that at least the big idea of the plan is there before the elections.
Great. I know a really clever man who is in here today. I'm not going to say who it is to keep the tension. But he said that his firm belief is that if those parties would do this, form this alliance, they would accumulate more votes as a sort of a total number between them. I don't know how they would all go, but that's his belief, and he's very clever. So, a comment. Now, we have 6 minutes, so if anybody has a burning or yearning sensation for a comment or a question, the time is now, Snæbjörn. If not, I'm going to close this meeting very briefly after when it's 1:10, so everybody can get to their meetings and so on. And in case anybody starts talking for a long time, I will say now thank you. And again, maybe hopefully in the end, but thank you.
Just one very short comment. I think it's a gross mischaracterization to claim that the criticism of the Venice Commission have not been taken into account. I think they have been taken into account if you look at the history of the process.
I just wanted to remind you that the present constitution of the Republic of Iceland is based on the Royal Constitution of 1874. Who agreed to that constitution? The king, yes. Not parliament, not the public. It is as undemocratic constitution as we can possibly imagine. Will we ever have a Republican democratic constitution in this country, or is it hopeless?
Okay.
Hi, I'm Bergþór with the Pirate Party. I'm glad to hear you want to put it in this matter a priority. For future reference, we can most of us agree that one of the largest barrier for the ratification of the new constitution was Parliament itself. Would you be willing to outsource it completely, so that the Parliament has basically no effect except to ratify it?
That's a question to the parliamentarians, I think. Yeah. So if we start in the middle now, Valgerður?
To answer this question?
Yes, just very briefly.
Well, this was actually what was the process in the last term was. That was to outsource this completely, and then obviously the hope was that Parliament would agree to it. It didn't. And we just have to continue. We have to be patient and we have to struggle on.
Okay, so maybe you mean that we completely trust the people and we don't take it through all the traditional work that is done in the Parliament. I think, you know, if we want to get technical, one of the problems we faced was that there was we outsourced then to experts the greinagerð appendix or
accompanying documents.
Yes. So for some weird reason in Icelandic law, you can't change that once it's been put forward. I really don't understand the logic behind that. I think if it is obvious the Parliament is always the obstacle, then maybe it is time to that the Parliament would just ratify it. I think that's what you mean. Yeah, why not try that? I mean, we've tried the other thing for 70 years and we're still here.
Theodora?
Yes, the question is if it should...
if it's possible, I think, to get the Parliament to sort of make itself bound by the output from the people and just ratify it without...
Yes, as the gentleman here at the front told us in the beginning, it is the start of it was Stjórnarskrárfélagið, sort of outsource. It's from the roots, it's at the beginning, and we should maybe if it, the Parliament is not going to after the election going to work it on, I think we should maybe start to work again.
Thank you. Kadrin?
Well, I think if the Parliament is going to ratify it, the Parliament needs to discuss it. And I'm very sorry for sounding realistic, but that's just the way it is.
Thank you. There's one last question now from Ingólfur?
Yeah, not a question that I need answer to now, but I think it's good to have a plan before the election, but I really want what I want from each of your parties, and preferably as many parties as possible, is a promise that you will finish this during the next term. So not, you don't need to give it today, but before the election, I want this promise.
Okay.
Thank you.
So that, yes.
Promise something, you cannot promise something except your will and your party's will. But you cannot promise that there are not going to be obstacles in the parliament, if you know what I mean. So I mean, yeah, everybody wants, you know, at least speaking for myself, I can promise I will do everything in my power to make sure that this constitution is going to be ratified. But I think it is dangerous to promise something you can't keep.
I think that sort of probably is the same for all. But now it's 10 past 1, and I'm very proud to end this meeting at the correct time. So thank you all.